Hi, everybody, and welcome to our webinar today. It seems such a shame to stop the absolute guitar shredding in the middle of their shred. But alas, we need to get going because we have a great webinar planned for you. My name is Allison O'Connor, and I am the horticulture specialist in Larimer County. And with me today is Amy Lentz, horticulture specialist in Boulder County, Darren Davidson, our sustainable landscape specialist statewide, and Don Bradkin, a master gardener coordinator in Arapahoe County. So we are your pilots, and our presenter is Dr. Tony Koski, who we will introduce in just 1 second. We have a couple housekeeping things for you. The first is that this webinar is being recorded just like all of the others. Once it's been converted, we will post it to the cohorts blog where you signed up for this webinar. You went to that link. We can post that into the chat to make sure that you have that information to sign up for future webinars. And we also want to let you know that CSU is an equal opportunity access and non-discrimination university. If there's anything we can do to accommodate your needs, please let us know. We're happy to do that. And today is the first of 5 webinars that we're kicking off for our spring gardening series. So today is Organic Lawn Care with Dr. Tony Koski, but we have several others that are planned through May 5th. So that link will be posted into the chat. We encourage you to join us every Friday. Even if you can't join us live, we would still encourage you to register because then you will get the follow-up information and the link hot off the press from our presenter when it's available. One other thing too is that we have enacted the Q&A feature, so we will be closing the chat once Dr. Koski starts, but in the Q&A, you can actually upvote questions that we can make more prominent that our speaker will then address, so you can utilize that feature. Otherwise, we'll be on the back end answering those questions. So without further ado, really pleased to introduce you to Dr. Tony Koski, who is our Extension Turfgrass Specialist at CSU. He has decades of experience, and he's going to take it away with organic lawn care. Thanks for joining us today.
Thanks, everyone, for being here. We'll jump right into it because I've got a lot to cover and only an hour to do it. So appreciate you sharing your lunch hour with me. So one thing I wanted to point out here where is my email address? Is it there? I guess it isn't. Put my email address in the chat. Anyway, if you want to follow me on Twitter, there's my Twitter handle. There's the URL for our blog, which everyone should know about by now, because that's how you register for these. But in any case, let's talk a little bit about the organic lawn management. The first thing is, and I work with people, sometimes companies that want to, lawn care companies that want to become organic, or park systems, or school systems, or HOAs, whatever the case might be. And one of the first things I ask them about is, why do you want to go organic? And it happens there's a desire for any number of reasons, and some of it, and probably the most common response is, I just don't want to use chemicals, whatever that means. And that could mean pesticides in some people's minds, or it could mean synthetic fertilizers, or all of the above. It could be that they just have concerns about water quality. Maybe they live near a lake or streams or something like that, and they're worried about some of the lawn care products that might use getting into the water. It could be the groundwater, it could be surface water. It could be concerns over pollinators, their kids playing in the backyard, their dogs. And sometimes it might be, I think it'll be cheaper if I do organic lawn care. And maybe, kind of depends on what you have been doing, whether you're going to realize the cost savings there. And then sometimes people or entities are just required to. It could be whole entire school districts decide they're going to be organic, or in the eastern part of the United States, especially, there are towns that want to try to become organic and or park systems, whatever the case might be. So people do it for different reasons, but I never discount those. It's like in my mind, if you have a reason you want to do this, totally valid in my mind. And so I do give quite a few talks on organic lawn care. I regularly teach for a company called Clean Air Lawn Care. And I just did one of those 2 days ago or something. And their desire is to do organic lawn care in all of their 60 plus branches across the United States. They started in Fort Collins and now they're in 60 places across the country. So I talked to their lawn care folks, their boots on the ground, about how to do things, quote unquote, naturally or organically. So there is a lot of interest in this. You know, one of the things is what are some of maybe the obstacles to the adoption of organic lawn care? And one of the big ones from a lawn care professional lawn care perspective is there's no legal definition of organic turf care or organic lawn care, unlike for organic vegetable production or organic milk or organic grain production. There are federal guidelines for what qualifies as organic in those different programs, the National Organic Standards Program. And so in some parts of agriculture, there are very well-defined regulations and rules, hoops to jump through to be considered organic, but that does not exist in the lawn care industry. So people, companies, entities, whatever, they can say they're organic and they can be as far from what most people would consider to be organic as possible. So I only say that because it's kind of a consumer warning thing, is that just because a lawn care company puts on their website, we do things organically, I would not take them at their word for that. Not that I distrust our colleagues in the green industry, but there are some companies that are more scrupulous in their definition of organic than others. So ask them what they're putting on your lawns, and if you truly want organic, and what they're putting on there, it's hiding 2,4-D for dandelions or whatever the case might be. They're probably cheating a little bit. Some other obstacles is sometimes we don't have really good, especially in pest management, good organic alternatives. There are no really good, very effective disease management tools that are natural or organic. And as far as weeds go, it's a pretty short list of really effective natural or organic tools. For insects, we got lots of good organic tools. So that may limit for an entire lawn care program how effectively they can be truly organic. But organic turf care can be expensive, and some of that's because the products, there's not a lot of competition, or they're expensive to make the products. From the fertilizer perspective, organic fertilizers are rarely very concentrated. It's about the highest you're going to see with a true organic fertilizer is about 12% nitrogen. And then it goes down very rapidly from there to many products that you can buy are only 2 or 3% nitrogen, which means that the majority of that bag, the other 97% or 98% of what's in that bag that you're spreading, is not fertilizer, it's organic matter. And there's nothing wrong with that, but that's an expensive way to ship and move nitrogen around. And so natural organic fertilizers tend to be more expensive, especially when you calculate a per pound of nitrogen you're getting with those products. Sometimes there's a perception that if you're organic, you're going to have weeds. And that might be true. This picture on this slide, this is from Chicago, and the city of Chicago wanted all their parks to go organic. They did that. This shows one of those parks in the spring. And if you're a dandelion lover, you're going to love this park. And little kids love this park. But they got enough complaints for some of their more highly used and more visible parks that they actually went back to conventional management of those parks just to maintain some semblance of weed control in those parks. So sometimes you do have to separate a little or suffer a little bit decline in quality. But I would tell people that if you're going to do organic lawn care anywhere in the United States, this part of the world is where you want to do it. Colorado, Utah, New Mexico, Wyoming, this part of the country is, it should be pretty easy if you want to practice organic lawn care and have a fairly weed-free and pest-free lawn to do it here. And that's mainly because it's dry and we can very closely control, and we should closely control the amount of water we put on our lawns. In places where it rains and we can't control the rain, you know, where they're getting 40, 50, 60 inches per year, that amount of precipitation add the humidity that goes along with that, you're going to have a whole lot more true disease problems. You're going to have more insects problems. You're going to have more weed problems, and those problems are going to be more severe to the point where it really is difficult in a place like Ohio to practice organic lawn care and have a truly kind of darn near weed-free and pest-free lawns. It's really hard, or it's really expensive. So depends on where you're at, but this is the place to do it. Colorado is the place to do it if you want to do organic lawn care. Now, part of it is just people just don't know what to do. They don't know what is organic product, what qualifies, and how to define it, and that type of thing. And sometimes it's just it involves change. People don't like to change. It's like, no, I'll just keep using my turf builder. It's just easier. You know, I got a Scott's spreader, I got Scott's turf builder, I got Scott's cryograss preventer. And that's what the Scott's company banks on, quite honestly, is that you just kind of get locked in. They make it kind of, or you know, you don't get no-brainer kind of lawn care. And that's what they hope for. And when you're doing organic stuff, you have to buy your own products and learn calibration and be very discerning about what you put in that lawn. So you have to be a bit of a lawn nerd, I guess I would say, to really be successful at do-it-yourself lawn care. So, and I don't know why I have that picture in here, but must be some reason. Maybe that's sometimes in some people's minds, this is what you have to expect with organic lawn care, is that you might have a few weeds in there. And that's not really the case. You can have a weed-free, naturally organic lawn. And then sometimes, oh, I know I put this in here, is I visited with a park. I'll try to make this a quick story. A park, I won't say what town it is, in the park system, actually, in Colorado. And they called me in after 2 years of going organic. And they had so many complaints from so many people in that town about the quality of the turf in their parks. They were using this, you know, soccer clubs were using the parks and the schools and just people just playing with their kids. And except for a very small vocal minority, which kind of loved this kind of turf quality, most of the people said, this is like terrible. And why do we have so many weeds in our parks? And so I went down there and we walked the parks, and some of them were pretty much weed free, except for a lot of clover in them. So we came up with a plan to manage some of those parks organically or naturally, because it's a long story about why some did well under that regime and others did horribly, like this park. But what it actually came down to was the age of the soil and the turf in some of those parks. The very old ones did pretty well with the natural regime. And the very newest parks, they did horribly. And it was mainly because they were supplying almost no nitrogen to these parks. The turf was not very competitive. And so the weeds just took over in some of those parks. So And it was, they were getting bad information from a consultant they were paying boatloads of money to. So they fired him. They hired me for nothing, and they got their parks back in shape. And as far as I know, still today, some of those parks are they're in good shape, and some are still being managed organically and doing equally well. So what do we use for organic lawn care? There are a lot of fertilizers that are available, and these fertilizers have been available for, you know, 20, 30 years. When I was a grad student at Ohio State, I was doing research with organic fertilizers. It's kind of embarrassing to talk about this now, but at that time, when we had a turf field day, my advisors wouldn't let me talk about my organic fertilizer research plots because they were afraid that that Ohio State would be labeled as whack jobs or wackos, organic nuts, and they wouldn't even let me talk about my organic trials at field day. So back then there was kind of this, you know, you didn't do things organically, and that's in Columbus, which is where, you know, very close by, 20 miles away, was where Scott's lawn care is still located. And then the Chem Lawn Company, which is now called True Green, was headquartered and started in Columbus. So they just didn't want to be associated with the organic way of doing things. And so things have changed, and it's cool to be organic now, and it's recognized as a legitimate way to manage turf. But even today, all these many years later, we still don't have a lot of good pest management tools for organic lawn care, but we got lots and lots and lots of fertilizers. One of those fertilizers a nice local one, is from the Rich Lawn Company, which uses composted chicken poop, essentially. We call DPW in polite company, dehydrated poultry waste. So that's what the Rich Lawn Company puts in their Rich Lawn fertilizers. Now, they do have some that are, we call them kind of blended products, where they put a little synthetic urea and potassium sulfate and that kind of stuff in their fertilizers to help with a little extra greening and growth. But they do have strictly organic, natural one that's called Organic 100. Meaning it's 100% organic, and all that's in that bag is composted chicken poop in a nice little granule that will go through your fertilizer spreader. So we've got some good fertilizers available to us. You know, when you go around the country, the source of what we call the feedstock, what goes into these organic fertilizers, differs by geography. So in the Midwest, there's a lot of organic fertilizers that have corn in them, corn gluten meal. You get onto areas where there's a lot of livestock production, then we have a lot of blood meal and meat meal and bone meal going into fertilizers. And those are great fertilizers, widely used in the golf course industry. They're expensive, but just great sources of nitrogen. Places where you raise a lot of chickens or turkeys, feather meal. So there's a company out of Minnesota that does turkey DPW and feather meal based fertilizers. So, fish meal on the coast, and crab meal and that kind of thing. You get into Texas, cottonseed meal. There's a lot of regional uses of agricultural products that can make great fertilizer. So I encourage people to, whenever possible, to use locally manufactured and locally supplied natural organic sources, because they are, you are shipping a lot of stuff, a lot of organic matter to move a little bit of nitrogen. So there's a big carbon footprint involved in moving organic fertilizer across the country. So you may want to pat yourself on the back for being organic, but if you're using a fish kelp fertilizer manufactured in Massachusetts, I would not call that being maybe sustainable, if you want to throw that term around, which I kind of hate using because nobody knows what it means. When you've got right in your own backyard, alpha lawn, and I got some pictures here somewhere. Good old alpha lawn or rich lawn fertilizer. So use locally manufactured products for your organic lawn care whenever you can. Although here's one that I do recommend a lot. There's one that says, what are some of the fertilizer groupings, if you will, in the organic fertilizer world? One of them is what we call biosolids. And this is human waste. So this is from, probably the biggest and most well-known one is milorganite from Milwaukee Sanitary District. And so it's activated sewage sludge. So they bake this stuff at about 1200 degrees. It kills all the viruses and nasty stuff. They take all the metals out. It's remarkable how much silver and gold and nickel and cadmium and all kinds of stuff they get out of the sewage sludge. And so they clean that stuff up to the point where you can now use milorganite in vegetable gardens. That did not used to be the case 20 years ago. There was a very bold writing on the milorganite bag telling you do not use this in vegetable gardens. And it wasn't because of pathogen concern, it was because of the heavy metals. But now milorganite is so clean as far as heavy metals go, and certainly pathogens, that it's perfectly safe even to use in vegetable gardens. So that's what we mean by biosolids. And then we have the animal-based manures, and these could be, most often it's chicken or turkey, what we call dehydrated poultry waste. Here's the one from Minnesota. The company up there is called Sustain. And so this is a turkey litter and feather meal, and they put some other plant material in there, and a very, very nice fertilizer. But again, you can see the analysis of this, 4-6-4. So 14% of what's in that bag is nutrients, and the other 86% is organic matter. Again, nothing wrong with putting organic matter, but when you're talking about shipping this and moving it and putting it on trucks, or consider at the other end, lawn care companies have to store large amounts of stuff, so they need larger storage facilities if they're doing organic fertilization, just to store the amount of fertilizer they need. So that space is expensive. The labor to move it around is expensive. If you're on the pushing end of a fertilizer spreader every day, and you're doing organic lawn care, you smell like turkey litter by the end of the day, and you taste it, and you're very tired because you've been lifting a lot of bags and pouring a lot of bags into that spreader. So that's part of the reason organic lawn care can be a little more expensive, is because the fertilizer, the labor, the pest management products are all very expensive when you're doing things naturally or organically. And then we have some people call these food grade fertilizers. And these would be products that are made from feedstocks that have not been eaten by an animal or humans. So obviously sewage sludge, we ate food and the leftovers go to the sewage treatment plant. Your chickens and your turkeys eat their feed. You get chicken feathers and chicken poop. So they've taken the energy, the whole reason that we eat something for lunch when we eventually eat lunch, or maybe you're enjoying that now. I applaud you for that. But we eat food to get energy, derive energy from that food. That's how we stay alive. But what comes out the other end isn't very energy intensive. And so the companies that make what we call food grade fertilizers, they say that their fertilizer is better for the soil because the microbes down in the soil, the bacteria and the fungi and the actinomycetes and the little decomposers in the soil, they get more energy from their fertilizers than from the Sometimes they're derogatorily referred to as spent energy products. So again, here's Nature Safe. This is another Midwestern product. And this one has meat meal, bone meal, blood meal in it. This is basically leftover parts from the meat processing industry in the Midwestern United States. Just an outstanding, beautiful fertilizer, just wonderful. But again, see, it's we're talking, 17% of what's in there is nutrients, and maybe round up to, if you add everything up, maybe 20%. The other 80% is still organic matter. But again, this is a energy chocked source of fertilizer, if you will. So, you know, another way of fertilizing doesn't involve fertilizer is putting clover in your lawns, and that's a totally legitimate way of fertilizing lawns. You know, certainly back in the 30s, 40s, even into the 50s, grass seed mixes that you would buy from like Scotts intentionally had clover added to those, to that grass seed mix. And this is still the case throughout much of Europe. But now there's, this thing goes in cycles. People say, oh yeah, there's a lot of demand for clover lawns. And yeah, there was like 10 years ago, and then 10 years before that. It kind of goes in these cycles where people get all excited about clover lawns. And maybe the latest craze and the latest interest will be or persist a little while. But I looked at these 10 years ago, these microclovers. And so this is not a new idea at all. But if you want to think of it as new, that's cool too. But it's been around forever, and we know that legumes, being legumes, they have that bacterial association in their roots systems, that and the bacteria takes nitrogen out of the air, converts it into a nitrogen form that the bacteria can use, but then the bacteria shares that with the plant. So it's that symbiotic relationship. And then in doing so, this whole symbiotic process, some of that nitrogen leaks out of the clover roots, leaks out of the little bacteria when they die, and it can fertilize the turf that are growing the turf growing next to the clover. So the idea is, if you put enough clover into your lawn, it will fertilize the turf. And that is absolutely true. It can work this way. And you can see in this little picture from this company in the Netherlands, DLF Trifolium, the second largest grass seed or seed forage seed company in the world. They sell something that's called micro clover. And I've tested this stuff. Here's a weird thing, and it might have just been a geography thing. I don't know what it was. The micro clover I got from them did not stay micro at all. I tested it up in 4 counts for 3 years. And it was far from micro. It overshadowed and grew much taller than the grass. It did not stay well behaved. And you know, the grass was under the clover, and their version of the micro clover, at least the way it seems to work in the UK and Europe, is that the clover grows under the grass and you hardly see the clover. So I don't know what happened. Maybe I got a bad batch of seed. But I've tried it a couple times and it doesn't seem to stay very micro here, but that's okay. Some people want totally 100% clover lawns, and that's cool. And you never will have to fertilize those. And that is a certainty. So that's another way to maybe organically or naturally fertilize your lawn. But in summary, there are a lot of fertilizers out there. Oh, I like to throw this picture in too. This was actually in that same park, in that town I won't name. So they had a lot of clover in the parks, and they also had a lot of this one. So this is black medic. This is also a legume. People often consider this to be a weed, but I've been on people's lawns where they haven't fertilized their lawn for 10 years or who knows how long, and their lawn is predominantly black medic. And they want to know how to get rid of that weed. And I've actually told people, you know, you have a pretty nice black medic lawn. This is a clover. And so that would be kind of an option to let your lawn get invaded by black medic. And it doesn't take too much to do that. And you can find black medic seed online and intentionally seed it, and it will take over lawn. if you're not watchful. So clover can be a legitimate nitrogen source. So before I go on to bugs and crud, what kind of questions are, man, I see a lot of questions, or at least a lot of comments.
Hey, Tony, we've been getting a lot of questions. One of them was about the local products. I put in there that Rich Lawn is made in Platteville, but I couldn't remember. Do you know where the Alpha Lawn 2 is made?
Well, their headquarters, at least on the bag, says Loveland.
Okay.
But I think that's where their office is. I know it's made locally. What Alpha Lawn is, it's alfalfa that has been, it's got moldy, or the palatability, the protein level is not quite where maybe a horse owner or even a cattle, cow operations would not buy that alfalfa for whatever reason. And they grind it and pelletize it into little pellets. It kind of looks like what you would buy for your gerbil or your hamster. And it smells really good. You know, the Rich Lawn fertilizer, it's not a horrible smell, but it smells like chicken poop. But Alpha Lawn has a really pleasant alfalfa. And if you've ever never smelled fresh cut alfalfa, it's got a really nice aroma to it. But it's a great fertilizer. They put a little urea in it. So they, if you want to call it cheat, I don't call it cheating, but they just put a little urea. And the reason that many organic companies put a little synthetic fertilizer in their product is if you put an organic product down and the microbes don't work on it real quickly, either you don't have a real healthy soil, or the soil's cold, or you keep your lawn real dry, all those conditions slow down the decomposition by the bacteria. And so all those fertilizers, they need bacteria to eat it first. And then the microbial activity releases the nitrogen. That can take a while. So the companies will put a little bit of free nitrogen in to give you a little early greening to make you feel like I didn't get ripped off by this fertilizer. And then that gives time for the microbes to do their work and release that nitrogen. So,
Tony, I've got another question for you. We've had a few different people ask about organic suggestions to get rid of crabgrass.
Yeah, I'm going to get into that. Okay. Yeah. So we'll talk about the pest management. So if you've been doing questions on organic grub or weed control, kind of hold those because I'll answer those. Any other ones that were toughies? Oh, here's one. Are you worried about PFOs and PFAs and biosolids? I won't say that's not a legitimate concern. These things do exist. So what they're talking about is if you analyze biosolids for other stuff that's in them, besides heavy metals and other things, just because of our society and the stuff that we use for medication, that we use for birth control, there's a lot of chemistry that people put in their bodies. There's a lot of chemistry that's, whether you like it or not, is in some of the food that you eat. And some of that chemistry ends up in sewage sludge. Here's the other thing, is that sewage sludge is not just from homes and human dwellings. In the more industrial parts of like place like Milwaukee, you have industrial waste. And so all of this waste is being processed and put into this sewage sludge material. I'm going to be upfront and tell you, I haven't done as much research as maybe I should do or could do on that. I know it's a legit concern. As you would expect, California is the state leading the charge on looking at what's in biosolids and that type of thing. So I'm not going to say it's something not to be worried about. I'm just going to say, yes, the concern does exist. And it may be totally valid. The thing is how long do those last once the fertilizers applied, and then do microbes degrade those? And that's the part I couldn't answer. Yeah, so I won't deny that they're not in the fertilizer, but do they persist for very long in the soil system? That's probably the more important question to answer. And I don't know the answer. I'll try to do a little research on that. And so those of you that are concerned about that, or maybe when I send the email out, maybe I'll send you some links to what I would call science-based, because I know there's, just like with everything else in life these days, there's a lot of very biased information on topics, pesticides, politics, all this stuff, synthetic turf, any topic you bring up. So I'll try to find some good science-based information and answer that question, but it's a good question. It's a very legit question. Okay, we good on questions?
I think we're good, Tony.
Let's look at bugs and crud before I run out of time. Oh my gosh, close already. So some organic or natural ways to fight insects. Let's start with the insects, because those were our great options are. You can buy seed now, grass seed, that is what we call endophyte enhanced. It has a fungus on the seed. When the seed germinates, the fungus gets into that little grass seedling. It grows in that grass plant. And as long as that grass plant's alive or another plant attached to it, you know, the way grass plants grow, they send off side shoots called tillers, or they will grow rhizomes or stolons and creep. As long as that fungus was in the original mother plant, it will move with all of the offspring shoots and leaves. Okay. A few things about endophytes: they don't grow in the roots, so it's only in the leaves. But what does the endophyte do? It makes the leaf of the plant taste terrible to things like caterpillars. So like sod webworms, which feed on grass leaves, they will not feed on rye grass or fine fescue or tall fescue that has endophyte growing in the leaves. They would rather die. They will starve to death in preference to eating this stuff. That's how bad it tastes to them. So it's wonderfully effective. Here's the downside of endophytes, though. As long as I've been trying, and endophytes have been around since about 1980, I think, is when the first endophyte enhanced ryegrass plant. So we're talking 40 years. Still cannot get endophytes to grow in Kentucky bluegrass or creeping bentgrass, the most used grasses in the north, either in golf and in home lawns and sports turf, and they can't get it to grow in Bermuda grass, the most used grass in the south. So it only grows in a very small list. Basically, rye grasses and fescues are the grasses that the endophyte grows in. But if you had a tall fescue lawn with endophyte enhanced tall fescue, you will never ever have sod webworms or army worms or cutworms. You won't have bill bugs in there, because the adult bill bugs feed in the leaves, even though the young ones feed, the larvae feed on the roots. They won't go there and they won't lay their eggs. Okay. But you could still have grubs, because the adult grub doesn't feed on grass leaves and it doesn't care where it lays its eggs. And so she's going to lay eggs in your tall fescue lawn, and those grubs aren't affected by the endophyte because it's not in the roots. So the other thing is, the endophyte doesn't spread with grass clippings. So you can't collect grass clippings from your endophyte enhanced lawn and dump it on your neighbor's lawn that doesn't have endophyte. It won't spread that way. The only way to put endophyte into a lawn is by seed. So that technology exists and it's pretty cool. Here's a picture where this is a bluegrass ryegrass mix. The ryegrass had endophyte in it, and the insects ate all the bluegrass and left all the ryegrass behind. That's how selective they are with their feeding. So it does work. And just what I said, it's only rye fescue, and only through seeding, only works on things that feed on the leaves. One other note, it's a very important one actually, is that endophyte enhanced grass will make sheep and horses and cattle ill, apparently not goats, but the rest of these, it will make them ill, and actually it can kill them. So it's interesting. Forage breeders do everything they can to keep endophyte out of their grasses, and turf breeders do everything they can to get endophyte into their grasses. And they're often working for the same companies. There are some things that are kind of labeled. You can read labels and say, oh, this will control bill bugs and lawns or chinch bugs. Here's a bill bug and chinch bug. Bovaria, Bassiana. This is used much more in greenhouse production for insect biocontrols. Technically, it can work in a lawn. In reality, you'd be wasting your money to use it in a lawn. It just doesn't persist. So use it in your greenhouse, but not in your lawn. What does work in a lawn? Some of these bacillus-based products, and I will emphasize saying some. Milky spore disease does not work, folks. Whitney Cranshaw is a little more diplomatic about the wording, but I'll just tell you it doesn't work. Research in many universities in the more eastern parts of the United States and the Midwest has shown you get almost no effectiveness for milky spore, but it's still sold. And it's sold by very good garden centers. Allison was teaching it a month ago, Al, or something, and they had milky spore. They were selling in their store, and it's like, it doesn't work, guys, sorry. And you know, that's what we do in Extension. We want to tell people the honest truth. And so maybe they're not selling it there anymore after we told them that. But they were selling. What they were selling was Grub Gone, which is good. Grub Gone does work. Grub Gone does work. And a sidelight, the mosquito dunkers, for if you got a pond or water feature, those do work, but only on mosquitoes. So these are all bacillus, these are all bacteria, and they tend to be somewhat specific. The nice thing about the Grub Gone, which also a related product is called Beetle Gone, these are specific to the white grub and the white grub beetle. So Japanese beetle, mast chafers, June beetles, those are the most common ones we get in Colorado lawns. It will broad spectrum do all the white grubs. And the nice thing is that if you have beetles that feed, which are Japanese beetles, the chafers and the June beetles don't do a heck of a lot of feeding, but we all know Japanese beetle does. You can apply the Beetle Gone, which is sprayable form of this bacteria. You can spray it on your roses, your perennials. You can spray it in your vegetable garden, edible plants. You can see right on the label here, residential, commercial, public landscapes, farms, and edible plants. This will not make you ill, your kids, your cat, your pollinators, totally pollinator safe, will not harm a pollinator. But it will kill adult Japanese beetle. And then the Grub Gone part, this is a granular put through your spreader. That's for the lawn. It's the same product, just in different physical form. So you have two ways of attacking Japanese beetle if you want to do it naturally, organically. Related product is called Grub Halt, very same organism. Okay. So Grub Halt or Grub Gone are very good. And they don't harm ladybird beetles, are good. Parasitic wasps are safe. So very, very specific to the bad guys and leave the good ones behind. We have nematodes that are very, very good at killing grubs, as well as some of the sod webworms, bill bugs, those kind of things, but especially grubs. And these are little worms, tiny, tiny microscopic worms that will get inside a grub. They multiply inside the grub, as you can see in this picture. They kill the grub, obviously, by their feeding. But interestingly, and I don't know if I have the life cycle, I don't. But interestingly, in each one of these little nematodes, there is a bacteria, not the same one as this, not a BT, but it is another bacteria that the nematode releases into the bloodstream of the grub. And actually it's the bacteria that oftentimes kills the grub. But I guess it's debatable which one kills it, all these little nematodes eating its guts or the bacteria that the nematode carries in there. So either way, the grub's a goner. They bust out, they go moving around looking for other grubs to infect. And so this is when you're, you know, if you ever dig around and you're finding grubs in your lawn, if they have this brown color, that means they were killed by the nematode. Whereas this is a healthy grub here. And so nematodes are not all the same though. You want to get, if you're going to do the nematode thing, you want what we call the heterorhabditis genus. The Steiner Nema ones don't work on grubs. The heterorhabditis ones do. These are used for other types of insect pests. So I'm not saying the Steiner Nema isn't a good product. It's got a different target audience, if you will, versus the heterorhabditis. Remember, these things are alive when you buy them. You know, when you buy the grub gone, it's dehydrated. You can store it and keep it for a while and it's not going to go bad. These nematodes, treat them like sushi. You don't want to keep it very, very long. Otherwise, you'll get some bad effects. And the bad effect here is they'd be dead. And they have all kinds of instructions about refrigeration and that type of thing. They have a use-by date, just like your milk or, you know, something I ate for dinner the other night that was 1 year and 1 week beyond the best by date. Although a doctor friend of ours told us, don't worry, she does the same thing. So anyway, but that would not work. Year-old nematodes will not be alive. I can guarantee you that. Apply them when it's dark or cloudy, water them in real well. Here's the thing. You want to apply these about the time that you're seeing the grubs. So we're talking like early mid-August, you want to be applying these things. Water them in real well. Lawn care companies that do grub management, they'll use the nematodes and the bacteria to provide a good grub control. So we've got some good options. We got the nematodes, we've got the bacillus. I put the milky spore in here just to put an X on it. Even though it says it works, it doesn't. Okay. So some good products there. And again, University of Massachusetts and University of Connecticut, that's like ground zero for Japanese beetle. It doesn't work. It really doesn't. University of Kentucky has done similar research and to find it doesn't work. Some other cool things out there that Whitney's working on. Here's a wasp called a Tiffia wasp. So this wasp finds the grubs, burrows down into the soil. She lays an egg on the grub. The egg hatches. Here's a little larva that's hatched and it's feeding, kind of like a hitchhiker, on this grub. And then here's the larva a few weeks later. And that's what's left of the grub. So you can see it dispatches those pretty quickly. And so Whitney's released some of these here. They need peonies. The adults need peonies as a food source. So if you like peonies, you can help with keeping Tiffia populations up. Pheromones, pheromone traps. These are good for telling when the pest problem is around. They are not good as a control measure. They're going to attract more problems than they solve. So these would be good. Put one out. You say, okay, Japanese beetle are out flying around, and maybe you don't need those. Maybe your roses or your Virginia creeper or your linden tree attract them. But then that's your sign when you see the adults. Wait about a week. They're mating. They're laying eggs, and that's when you start putting your biocontrols, your nematodes or your bacillus, your grub gone product out. Spinosad is an option. There are all kinds of generic spinosads. Interestingly, the Dow company, which everybody badmouths Dow, well, they're not Dow anymore, but in any case, they had one of the very earliest good, effective biological or organic control products for mainly for caterpillars. Now, we don't get lots of webworm and armyworms and that stuff here in the Midwest. There's a whole lot more. So this would work in a lawn if we had sod webworms, but we don't get that much. Here's something that's close to organic, but it's not really organic. Something called GrubX. And it's not organic because it's made in a factory. The chemistry is plant derived. And that's a cool thing. So, The other neat thing about this material, this Grub X, which is sold by Scotts, and then you can go online and buy a Celeprin. You know, most people don't want to spend $1,000 for a half a gallon. That's a bit spendy. There are smaller bottles that you can get now for, I think, $80, somewhere in there. But just get the Grub X from Scotts. Even if you don't like Scotts, this is one of the worthwhile products they sell. This is as close as you're going to get to natural organic. And I tell this to organic lawn care companies. I say, this is legit organic, but it'll never be OMRI certified organic because it's made in a factory. But this provides like 95% control of grubs, totally pollinator safe, human safe. In fact, it's so safe, it doesn't have caution, warning, or danger on the label. It's that safe. So an amazing product, really effective. I would use that if you have grub problems, and apply that probably sometime in like June 15th is a good time, somewhere mid late June. Water it in real well, and it'll last all the way into the fall. Let's talk about weed management. This is organic weed management. This is a picture taken from the CSU archives. Believe it or not, they used to have students and assign them patches of campus to pull weeds on. So can you imagine telling students they had to do that today? Wouldn't work. So what is out there for organic, to answer the question, for organic crabgrass control? I'll tell you, this is not the answer, even though it's promoted as the answer. And I'll tell you why it's not the answer, although why it might kind of sort of work too. So corn gluten meal for years was sold as a organic pre-emergent for crabgrass and foxtail and some other weeds. In the lab, in the greenhouse, this worked great. You took it outside, you had to use such absurdly high amounts of it that you couldn't afford to use it. And also, corn gluten meal is about 9-10% nitrogen. So when you use the amount needed to provide crabgrass control, you were putting absurd amounts of nitrogen on your lawn. So the grass was growing like crazy. And many people feel, based on research in a number of places, and I'll show you how many places have studied this, Oregon State, Cornell, some pretty good places. And they say, yeah, no, it really doesn't work. It doesn't do what's claimed. And that's because you have to put so much out that if in a lawn you're mowing like every other day, but it might give you the appearance of working because it makes the turf real healthy and vigorous and dense, okay? And that's how you keep weeds out of a lawn, by keeping turf healthy. So it might make you think it's controlling the crabgrass, but it's really the fertilizer effect that's preventing the crabgrass, if you will, okay? So same thing in your vegetable garden. The amounts you have to put out, your tomato plants will be 12 feet tall and they won't have any flowers or fruit because you're over fertilizing them. So use mulch, okay? There are some burn down products you can get that will kill weeds. These are non-selective. So they will turn your lawn brown. They might kill the weed. Here's an example, burnout. This is great on gravel driveways and paths and cracks in your sidewalk and places like that. And this is what it looks like. Here's a crack. In fact, there's a crabgrass plant sprayed before and after. I did this with this burnout material. That plant will still regrow. You'll have to, because you can see here, it didn't really kill the whole thing. So it's going to regrow. So you spray in your lawn. There's the crabgrass plant and the turf. Remember, the turf got sprayed too. Oh my gosh, look at the turf is totally toasted. And look at the weeds. They're still green and growing back. And they come out of that herbicide effect faster than the grass does. So this is not what you want to do. What can work? This doesn't work for crabgrass, but it can work for dandelions and thistle and that kind of thing, is these iron-containing products. There's a whole bunch of them, Fiesta, Iron X, Natria. There's one called Natria. There's a whole bunch of these on the market now. And they... They have concentrated iron, and the iron burns the leaves. Here's the thing, you have to reapply it. So you burn the leaves of the dandelion back, that's what it looks like, and it grows back. And then you spray it again, it grows back. You spray it again, there's a dandelion. Oh yeah, this is thistle. This is about an hour after spraying it. It looks impressive as heck, except it doesn't kill the plant. It doesn't kill the root system, okay? So you're not gonna get control unless you apply these about 3-4 times constantly to the same weed. So can they work? Yep, they can work. But you gotta be really persistent. I just wanna talk about this stuff a little bit. There's something called caprylic acid. You would not use this on a lawn, but people always want to know about maybe a replacement for Roundup in places where it's not your lawn, but in a gravel driveway and cracks in the sidewalk. This is a legit replacement for those, but this is one you're going to have to reapply. Here's some pictures, a picture I took. Here's 2 hours. This is a puncture vine. This is what it looked like before I sprayed it. You can see here's a little pigweed too. So this is the same plant. There's the pigweed plant. There it is afterwards. So this stuff, it toasts these annual weeds. And this is dead. It does not come back. As large as that weed was, it did not come back. So this caprylic acid, this stuff is sold in Home Depot and Ace Hardware. They called Burnout. You can get it online as Home Plate or Suppress, but it works really well. It smells weird. It's expensive. It works really well, though. Works best when it's hot and sunny day. It's only a contact, though. So you spray half of the plant, it doesn't get translocated to the other plant, the rest of the plant. So you have to get full 100% coverage. If you only spray half of it, only half the plant's going to die. So it works, but that's not real well. Here's another close to organic, but not truly. Tenacity, and now there's now generic Tenacity. This stuff used to be really expensive. Now there's just generic mesotrione. The chemical is called mesotrione. Scott's also sells this in a homeowner formulation on fertilizer. This provides great pre-emerge weed control. So this is pretty darn close to your crabgrass pre-emerge organic method. I would call it organic. And in fact, the organic company I taught for the other day, they use this in their organic lawn care program because this is a plant-derived product as well. So this is the answer to the crabgrass question. Here's what's gonna happen. You put it down. This is on existing crabgrass. Here's a dandelion. It turns it white. And so the plant can't photosynthesize and it dies. Yeah, so more annual grasses. This shows early symptoms. This shows when the plant's about ready to die. So it turns the wheat white, which is kind of a cool thing. So it's the starter crabgrass preventer that the Scott's product sells. Even works pretty well in some perennials. I'm not quite ready to promote this, but here's Tenacity taking brome grass out of a bluegrass lawn, which would be, if I can find a recipe to get this to work consistently, this will be a good recommendation. We're almost at the end. Disease management, the short answer is we don't have anything good. There's promising stuff out there. The only thing that's labeled for turf is this stuff. Here's the problem. This only works on leaf diseases. It might give you a little powdery mildew control on your bluegrass growing in the shade. But if you're going to spend money on this one, our Rosarian in Larimer County, Roger Hines, he swears by this stuff for mildew and black spot on roses. He says it's the best thing he's ever used. So this stuff's been actually researched at Cornell University. So it's a legit product. So if you're a rose person, you might try this stuff if you're getting disease problems. I was gonna talk about rabbits. Let's cut to the chase. If you got rabbits, what can you do organically if you don't consider trapping organic? Attract owls, there you go. this stuff's probably not really organic. This is organic, putting fencing up. Exclusion works for rabbits. But something else that seems to work somewhat pretty well, not always, is milorganite, the sewage sludge. So if you use this as your fertilizer in your lawn, rabbits seem to be encouraged to leave. And they don't like being around the smell. And also, interestingly, voles don't appear to like this stuff too. So there are mountain golf courses that put milorganite around the perimeter of their golf courses where it meets up with their native. And this is their method of preventing vole invasion onto their courses during the winter, where they're getting like 3-4 feet of snow on those golf courses. Takes a lot. You have to apply it, a lot of it. But it seems like the voles and rabbits don't like it. So, one other method, if you're squeamish, don't look at this. You can use traps. Here's a vole trails. This is in the summer. These are vole trails in this lawn. The voles are living in this stuff around the border of the lawn, find fescue and under weed barrier. So what they did was, we suggest just put mouse traps in the trails. You don't even have to bait them. Put them end to end so that there's another one here. You don't know which way the voles are going. This is where you close your eyes. Don't tell me I'm cruel. This is one of my colleagues. So he had these in his lawn, and he just texted me this picture the other day of a vole he got in his lawn by just putting the mouse trap in the trail. So, it's effective, and it's quick, and it's organic, I guess. So anyway, there's my email address to finish. What kind of questions do we have? Sorry for going over a little bit here.